Hi, this is Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at InterArbor Solutions, and you're listening to Briefings Direct. Our next thought leadership discussion explores how innovation and intelligence in business applications, data, and networks provide the best new hope for closing the digital transformation gap at many companies. A recent global survey of procurement officers and operation leaders shows a major gap between where companies are and where they want to be when it comes to digital transformation. While 83% surveyed see digital transformation as having a major impact on processes, only 5% see significant automation so far across their processes. How can business networks and cloud-based applications underlying them and supporting them help companies reach a more strategic level of business intelligence and automation? To learn, we're now joined by Darren Koch. He's the Chief Product Officer at SAP Ariba. Welcome to Briefings Direct, Darren.
Thanks so much. It's great to be here.
We're glad to have you. What's holding companies back when it comes to becoming more strategic in their processes? They don't seem to be able to leverage the intelligence and automation that will allow people to rise to a higher breed of productivity.
You know, I think a lot of it is inertia. The ingrained systems and processes that exist at companies impact a lot of people. And the ability for those companies to run their core operations relies on people and technology working together. And the change management that's required that we see in our customers as they deploy solutions, particularly in the move from on-premise to the cloud, is a major inhibitor. So it's not just the capabilities and the change in the new technology, but it's really relooking at and reimagining the process. The things that existed in a highly customized on-premise world and the way those things change in a digital-centric cloud world are fundamentally different.
It's always hard to change behavior. It seems like you have to give people a huge incentive to move past that inertia. Maybe that's what we're thinking about when we bring new data analytics capabilities to bear. Is that what you're looking at, sort of incentivization, or how do we get that gap closed?
I think you're seeing on the thought leader executive side, you're seeing companies that are more willing to look holistically at their processes and saying, is this something that truly differentiates my company and adds sustainable competitive advantage? And the answer on some processes is no. And so moving away from some of the complex on-premise deployments that were built in a world where the truck of consultants would show up and configure your software to do exactly what you wanted, moving to a data-centric best practice type of world that then gives you this scale. When everybody's operating in the same general business fabric, you see the emergence of things like business networks.
And why procurement and supply chain management and operations folks? Why are they in a really advantageous position to start to leverage these larger scale holistic benefits and then evangelize them?
You know, there's been a ton of talk and innovation on the selling side, on the CRM side. Our announcement of C4HANA at Sapphire and, you know, the success in the cloud generally around the CRM space. What most people kind of stop at is for every seller, there's a buyer. And we represent the buy side, right? The supply chain, the purchasing departments. And on the buy side, we have the opportunity to follow the same thought process as the sell side. Now, the beauty at Ariba is we have the world's biggest business network. We have over $2 trillion of buy side spend that we see. And our ability to take that spend and find real insights and real actionable change to drive value on the intersection of buyers and sellers is where we're headed.
Sure, it seems like we're moving rapidly beyond buy and sell being transactional and more into deeper partnerships, visibility, understanding the process on both sides of the equation that then brings about a whole greater than the sum of the parts.
Exactly. So, you know, I spent 10 years working in the consumer travel space, and we were working on, my team in particular, was working on how consumers choose hotels. And it's a very complex purchase decision. There's location aspects, there are quality aspects, there are amenities, room size, obviously price. There are a lot of non-price factors that go into the purchase decision. And when you look at what a procurement audience is doing, what a company is doing, there are a lot of non-price factors. It's exactly the same problem. Mm-hmm. Now, what we're getting to, and when you look at the investments we're making inside of SAP Ariba, you're seeing things like supplier risk. You're seeing things like the Ariba network handling direct materials. You're seeing time and quality and risk factors and these other non-price dimensions coming in the same way that consumers do when they're choosing a hotel. Nobody chooses the cheapest one, or very few people do. Usually it's a balance of all of these factors and how they best meet the needs. Mm-hmm. We're seeing the same thing on the procurement side.
Yeah, it's an interesting analogy. As consumers, we have information at our fingertips so that we can be savvy and smart consumers better than any other time in history, probably. But that doesn't always necessarily translate yet to a larger business-to-business type of affair. So what sort of insights do you think businesses will want when it comes to that visibility? What are we talking about that the data and the awareness of methodologies and process can elevate when we go beyond just the pure transaction and the price equation?
You know, I think that starts with the basics. It starts with, how do I know my suppliers? How do I, at scale, handle things like, is this supplier GDPR compliant? Do they have slavery or forced labor in their supply chain? Where are they sourcing their materials? So all of these aspects around supplier risk are the basics, right? Knowing your supplier is the basic element. And then when you go beyond that, it's things like, well, how do I weigh geographic risk? How do I weigh supply chain risk? And all the things that the practitioners of those disciplines have been screaming about for the rest of their companies to pay attention to the value that they're providing. It's really that progression and looking at, you know, there's a huge opportunity to look at the way companies collaborate and share data strategically to drive efficiency in the process, to drive efficiency ultimately in the whole value chain that leads to a better customer experience at the end.
Of course, customer experience is so important across the board. Must be a big challenge for you on the product side to be able to contextually bring the right information and options to the end user at the right time. Otherwise, they're overwhelmed or they don't get the benefit of what the technology and the business network can do. So what are you doing at SAP Ariba to help bring that right decision-making, almost anticipating where the user would go in the applications and services themselves?
So a lot of that starts with our investments in replatforming to HANA, SAP HANA. And that feeds into the broader story about the intelligent enterprise, right? Purchasing is one facet. Supply chain management is a facet. Sales is a facet. Production, all of these components are elements of a broader story of how you synthesize data into a means where you have a digital twin of the whole enterprise. And then you can start doing things leveraging the in-memory capabilities of HANA around scenario planning, around what are the implications of making this decision? What happens when a hurricane hits Puerto Rico and your supply chain is dramatically disrupted? And then that extends to, who are my suppliers who are disrupted? Who are my people on the ground there, and how are they disrupted, and how should my business respond in an intelligent way to the world events that happen all the time?
Mm-hmm. We've talked about the intelligent enterprise. Let's hypothetically say that when one or two or a dozen enterprises become intelligent, that they gain certain advantages, which compels the rest of their marketplace to follow suit. Well, when we get to the point where we have, you know, a majority perhaps or a critical mass of intelligent enterprises, how does that elevate to an intelligent economy? What can we do when everyone is behaving with this insight, anticipating and having tools like SAP Ariba at their disposal?
Yeah, I think you hit on a really valuable and important point. way back, I was an economics major, and there was a core thing that I took away from 20 years ago in my intro macroeconomics class. And the core of it was everything is either value or waste. Every bit of effort, everything that's produced around the world, every good or service is either valuable or it's waste. There's nothing in between. And so the question is, when we look at the value chains, when we look at these webs of value, how much of that is transaction cost? How much of that is information asymmetry? How much of that is basic barriers that get in the way of ultimately providing value to the end consumer? Where is all of that waste? And when you look through complex value chains and you look at all of the inventory sitting in warehouses, you look at the things that go unsold, you look at the mismatches between supply and demand across a value chain, whether you're talking about direct materials or you're talking about pens and paper sitting in a supply closet, it really doesn't matter. It's how much of that goes to delivering what your customers, your employees, your stakeholders value, and how much of it is waste. As we link these data sets together, the real production planning, the understanding of end consumer, end user demand, all the way back the supply chain, gets all that transparency, brings a ton of value. And then at the other side, consumers understanding, getting pushed backwards, ultimately helps everyone in the value chain understand what the consumers value so they can innovate in the right ways. Mm-hmm. And so I see this dramatically changing as you link these intelligent companies together. And as companies move the same way that people have moved into a sharing mindset, the sharing economy of using resources in a more efficient way is the exact same thing about how we use our data resources in a more efficient way.
Seems to me, Darren, that this also dovetails well with being purposeful as a business. Many organizations are trying to see in the economy at large a higher productivity, which helps raise wages, which reduces inefficiencies, creates better standards of life. So the stakes here are pretty high. If we can find this waste, we're not just talking about adding some dollars to the bottom line and top line, but we're also thinking about maybe a better economy that raises all boats.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, you see companies like J&J who at their core, from their founding principles, have the importance of their community as one of the core founding principles. You see it in companies like Ford and their long heritage. And those things are really coming back, you know, back from the decade of the 80s where greed was good, back to a more holistic understanding of the interconnectedness of all of this. And it's good as humans. It's also good from the business perspective because attracting and retaining the talent required to run a modern enterprise and building the brand that our consumers are demanding and holding companies accountable to, they all go hand in hand. And so the purpose aspect really addresses the broader stakeholder aspects of creating a sustainable planet, a sustainable business, sustainable employment, and things like that.
All right. When we think about attaining this level of efficiency through insights and predictive and analytics, taking advantage of business networks and applications as services, we're also on the cusp of getting even better tools at our disposal. We're seeing a lot more information about machine learning. We're starting to tease out the benefits of artificial intelligence. Now, when these technologies are maturing and become available, it seems to me that you need to be in a position to take advantage of them. And so moving towards the intelligent enterprise and digital transformation is not a good or nice to have. It's essential because of what's going to come next in the next few years.
I think you see this very tactically in the chief procurement officers that I've talked with as I've entered this role. I have yet to run across one or a business leader more broadly that says, I have so many resources, I don't know what to do. That's not usually what I hear. Usually it's the opposite. It's I'm being asked to do more with less. And when you look at the core of AI, the core of machine learning, It's how do you increase efficiency, whether it's all the way on the full process automation side or it's along the spectrum of bringing the right intelligence and insights to streamline processes, make better decisions. All of that is in an effort to up-level the work that people do. So that raises wages, it raises productivity, all of those things. We have an example inside our team. I was meeting with our head of our customer value organization, Chris Hayden, over dinner last night. And Chris was talking about how we were applying ML to enhance our ability to onboard new customers. And he said the work that we've done has allowed him to redeploy 80 people in his team onto higher productivity use cases. All of those people became more valuable in the company because they were working on things that were the next level of creating new solutions and better customer experiences instead of turning the crank in the proverbial factory of deploying our software.
Yeah, I happen to personally believe that a lot of the talk about robots taking over people's jobs is hooey, that in fact what's more likely is this elevation of people to do what they can do best and uniquely and let the machines do the same, what they can do best and uniquely. How is that translating into, one, SAP Ariba products and services, and two, the synergy between SAP at large and SAP Ariba particularly?
Yeah, I think inside of our products and services, you know, we're at a really exciting time. We're just getting through a major replatforming to HANA. And the company's at a really exciting time because HANA's maturity and its scale is starting to move beyond the basic infrastructure in the way that Hasso envisioned it so long ago when we started the initiative. And we're really getting to the point of not replicating data and using the ML algorithms and applying them, building them once and applying them at large. And so the investments in HANA, the investments the company's made in Leonardo, and how those create this toolkit of capabilities that the applications like SAP Ariba can leverage and see, like any good infrastructure investment, see scale happen quickly, see innovation happen quickly because we've set the right foundation. And so you'll see a lot more of how we leverage the data that we have both inside a company as well as across the network to drive intelligence into our process. And you'll just see that come through more and more as we move from the infrastructure foundation setting stage to building the capabilities on top of that.
Mm-hmm. And I suppose another change that's happened over the past 5 to 10 years that people may have lost track of or take for granted now is that when you're doing software as a service, these new technologies and advancements come to you automatically, for all intents and purposes. When we get back to that concept of closing the transformation gap for companies, what is it they should be thinking about when these services and technologies become available? How can they help close their own technology gap, perhaps by becoming acquainted in advance and taking some initiative to best use the tools that are basically in their stable now?
Yeah, I think a big part of it is, first, the companies that are forward leading on the digital transformation and have made the cloud move early. The next big move for them is, how do we start tapping into the business network? How do we start sharing across our value chain and driving the efficiency? And I think you'll see, and what we're seeing, is the shift from kind of tactical procurement to strategic procurement. What are the relationships that need to move from transactional, I'm going in and buying something, to a true partnership of how do we create value together? That change involves rethinking the way you look at data, the way you look at sharing data across the value chain, and getting to a situation of growing the pie instead of trying to figure out how to divide it.
Let's think a little bit about spend management conceptually. Now, congratulations, by the way, on your Gartner Magic Quadrant positioning on pay-to-procure processes. What is it from the accountant side of the house, you know, for those people that do look at the money and want to rationalize What is it about what we've been talking about leading spend management to become next? How does spend management become more strategic, if you will?
The building blocks for spend management always come down to what is our tactical spend and where should we focus our effort for building strategic spend? And whether that's in the services area or it's in travel or it's in direct materials or it's in indirect, what customers are asking SAP for is how do all of these pieces fit together? What's the difference between an RFP for a hotel in New York City versus an RFP for chemicals in Southeast Asia? They're both a series of running this business process of selecting the right vendor that balances all of the critical dimensions, price and everything else, to make a good decision that has some longevity. And so, you know, we see a lot of shared elements in the way you interact with your suppliers. We see a lot of shared elements in the way that you deploy this application inside your company, how well the different facets of the application work together, how seamless is the user experience, how well do all of these things tie together for all of the stakeholders, and ultimately, each element of the team, each element of the company has a role to play. And so the finance organizations desire to ensure that value is being created in a way that the company can afford, that the shareholders and employees and management and end users are all on the same page, is really the core of spend management in that sense, as well as the intelligent enterprise as a whole. Mm-hmm. By seeing everything, by bringing it all together, the company can better manage its full operations and how they create value.
The vision is very compelling. I can certainly see where this is going to be not just a small change, but a step change in terms of how companies can benefit and productivity at large can benefit. But as you were alluding to earlier, architecture is destiny when it comes to making this possible. By re-architecting around S/4HANA, by taking advantage of business networks, you're well on the way to delivering this. Let's talk a little bit more about, before we close out, some of the platform changes, some of the tactical changes that will grease the skids towards this larger holistic benefit.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, it's firmly our belief that the world is moving to these mega platforms. And SAP has a long history of bringing the ecosystem along, whether the ecosystem is delivering process innovation or the ecosystem is building capabilities on top of, or those capabilities are embedded deeply into the products. What you're seeing is, again, the shift from the on-prem world where that looked a certain way to a cloud world where it's API first, where it's business events driven, where you see a decoupling of the various components. And underneath the covers, it doesn't matter what technology stack things are built on. It doesn't matter how quickly they evolve. It's the assumption that we have this API contract between two different pieces of technology, an SAP Ariba piece of technology, an SAP S4 cloud piece of technology, a partner ecosystem piece of technology, a company like Solanas was up on stage with us at Ariba Live in Amsterdam, and that's one of the fastest companies. They raised a B round at $1 billion. Having companies that are driving innovation like that in partnership with SAP because we are working through the process to expose our APIs and enable a real platform that brings not just near-term value for us and our customers, but it brings a future-proofing. It brings extensibility. When there's a specific requirement that comes in for a specific industry or geography, or there's a way that you see as a customer to differentiate in a specific spot, you can plug in. And Concur's been down this path for a long time. The president of SAP Ariba, Barry Padgett, actually started the initiative of opening up the Concur platform. And so deep at our core and our roots, we believe that networks and ecosystem and openness is the thing that's going to ensure that our customers get the most value out of their solutions.
Right. And because you're a fairly early adopter of a multi-cloud concept and a philosophy, SAP can be everywhere at the most efficient level, given what the hyperscale cloud providers are providing and the global reach and efficiency there. But you're also everywhere when it comes to being in those enterprises and small to medium-sized businesses. So it seems to me a very interesting combination of embracing multi-cloud, but also having that position in the enterprise as established business applications and data sets. Before we finish off, tell me a little bit about that longer-term vision of why a hyperscale multi-cloud future benefits SAP Ariba and its customers.
Yeah, I think when you look across the landscape of the hyperscalers and you look at the pace of innovation, the level of scale that they're able to deliver, our lead time to get servers, to get boxes installed in a data center, and the workload variability that we see, whether it's test variability or it's our ability to run ML training models, these things revolve around the ability to scale up and down as required. The idea that we have multi-month lead times to get boxes installed in our data centers is something that we just can't afford. Our customers demand more. And thankfully, there's a solution. There are multiple solutions around the world that solve that problem while at the same time giving things like world-class security, giving things like geographic footprints and expertise. When a server fails halfway around the world and the expert is somewhere else, the hyperscalers provide a solution to that problem. They have somebody who, you know, walks through the data center and makes sure that the routers are upgraded, that the switches and load balancers and everything is working the way that it should. And whether that's data at rest inside of the Chinese firewall or it's data at rest inside of Europe, or how those systems interact, we need to do that investment on the application tier and working with our customers to handle all of the changes in the landscape around data and security. The hyperscalers give us that base level of infrastructure, and so we don't need to think about things like, is our air conditioner capacity inside of the data center sufficient to run the latest technology for the computing power? We don't worry about that. We worry about delivering value on top of that base level of infrastructure that takes our applications to the next level. It allows us, in the same way we were talking about earlier, the ML and AI freeing our resources to work on higher value things, it allows us to stop thinking about these base level things that are critical for the delivery of our service. It allows us to focus on the innovation aspects of what we need to do.
It really is about driving value higher and higher, and then making use of that in the way that's the most impactful to the companies, their consumers, and ultimately the whole economy. Well, I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there. You've been listening to a sponsored Briefings Direct discussion on how the providers of business solutions and networks are doing more to help companies reach a strategic level of business intelligence and automation. And we've learned how such business functions as procurement and supply chain management are providing a newfound wellspring from which to deliver insights and accelerate productivity. So a big thank you to our guest. We've been here with Darren Coach. He's the Chief Product Officer at SAP Ariba. Thank you, sir.
You got it.
And thank you as well to our audience for joining this Briefings Direct Modern Digital Business Innovation Discussion. I'm Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at Inter Arbor Solutions, your host throughout this series of SAP Ariba-sponsored Briefings Direct discussions. Thanks again for listening, and do come back next time.